Here's something off the request line from Liberty Island.
Do you want some coffee, Mr. Tolley?
We gotta squeeze some New Year's juice from you, Big Apple.
Yes, have some.
Yes, have some.
Ghostbusters Radio Live.
Hello, everybody. God, I'm already having audio issues. Hi, everybody. Craig from Yes, Have Some Podcast here. Welcome to GB Radio Live. I think it's these fucking headphones. Pieces of shit. Hi, Ryan. How are you?
Hi. I'm doing good.
What a way to start the show.
Yeah, what the heck?
Oh, it's all good. Hi, everybody. Ryan Dole joining me this week. Listen, I've been sick. Been having my body shut down on me. Too much ghostbusting. The Ghostbusters content. But we're gonna do this tonight. Ryan's joining me. John Yerkaba's supposed to be here, but he's having a technical difficulty. So he'll join us in a few. Joining me here on the channel, you know him from Toy Anxiety, and you know him from his work on Ghostbusters Frozen Empire. This is insane.
Insane.
Ryan Dole, what's up, man?
Not much. I'm sick too, Craig.
What are you sick of?
I'm sick of critics. That's what I'm sick of. I'm sick of people treating critics like they're relevant. And as the king of relevancy here on Relevancy Island,
yeah,
I declare film critics no longer relevant.
We're going to get into it. Oh, there. These headphones are... I don't know how Abby uses these headphones. Do I sound better?
Oh, yeah. You sound better. You look better.
Feel better.
Dude, you got like color back in your skin.
Oh, look at me go. Hi, everybody. So, you know, Norm, we don't really have a set night. We do GB Radio Live. We've just been doing it as we have felt the need and the urge to over the last year. You know, when we get out of the marketing period and the release period of Frozen Empire, we'll probably fall back into more of a steady, regular release pattern of streams and YHS podcasts. But tonight, it's Saturday night, 7 o'clock Eastern. We appreciate those who've joined us already. And as always, if you like what you see here on Yes, Have Some, hit the like button, hit the subscribe button. And by the way, a big thank you to everybody who's been watching Firehouse Fridays with all of our behind-the-scenes content from the set of Ghostbusters Frozen Empire. What I'm really excited about the next couple of weeks, I think are the most, the most fun videos we've had released. So next week, Jacob, Abby, and myself touring the Paranormal Research Center. Ryan, you've seen that one. It's pretty fun.
It's awesome.
There was a really funny moment. You know, I don't want to, that's behind the scenes. That's for next week. But Paranormal Research Center next week. And then we've got a really cool video coming after that, where they let us loose in the Ghost Corps war room. So it's just the three of us in the office looking at concept art and storyboards and all sorts of stuff. Excuse me. Maybe I'm not over being sick.
No. All right. Hang on. Take a deep breath. Need some water?
No, I'm good. I'm fine. And then we've got more videos after that. Lots of fun stuff to come. So we appreciate you guys being here. We appreciate the support. Joining us all the way from the... I don't know if he's in the West Coast.
He's in the mountains of Arizona, isn't he?
He's in the mountains of Arizona. Friend and artist, John Yerkaba. John, how are you?
I'm doing good, you guys. Sorry for the technical difficulties earlier. I'm not in the mountains. I am in mountain standard time, though, so I guess that
there
counts.
You go. He's in the mountain time. Yeah. Hey, I like this comment. We're going to say hi to the chat. Paul Rositer says, I love YHS. Why you don't have more subscribers is beyond me. Hey, I've been saying the same thing.
Oh, my God. For years.
We're getting there. We're getting there. It's a long story. But I'm really actually excited. The new YHS YouTube channel that we launched a year ago hit 5K subs this week. So super grateful for everybody sticking with us. Obviously Toy Anxiety is still killing it on the other channel. And we're just having a good time. John, haven't seen you online in a couple weeks, but I did see you in person a couple weeks ago.
That's true.
Thank you for doing the artwork for our party, for the premiere.
Yeah.
Really good reaction to that artwork.
Thank you. Yeah, no, that was really cool. It was an honor to do the one for Afterlife. And when you brought up doing the one for this one, I could not fathom saying no. That is something that, you know, it feels really special to be a part of it in that way. And also to like be a part of everything that you guys have built and what you've done with the podcast and being able to, you know, do the parties and be at the premieres and then seeing you guys on the red carpet, you know, this year was, I mean, literally the rest of us were in the fan pen watching your live stream and just borderline teary eyed, you know, with how proud we were of you guys. So to be part of it and to do all that. And then also, yeah, to, on a selfish note, to like get that kind of reaction of like everyone who came through and signed it and who got one at the party. And, you know, that it's really humbling for me and it, you know, it's especially with Ghostbusters, which is like the nearest and dearest thing to my heart in terms of like fandom and pop culture and everything.
Sure.
It affirms my, you know, desire to keep doing that kind of stuff. So,
well, you know, it's cool. Listen, let's just do a little, obviously Jacob and Abby are not here. We are not wishing them well on their future endeavors. They will be back, but
we're not even really wishing them well. Like at the moment, we're just kind of like, I hope you have an okay day.
Yeah. We hope you're doing okay. No, listen, we, all of us are in this very unique situation, right? Where John, you're a diehard Ghostbusters fan and you've made it your business to do Ghostbusters art and to involve yourself with the franchise and the fandom in any way that you can. And you've worked on the IDW comics and you did all that artwork for FanFest. And then, the YHS, we have dedicated our literally last 8 years of podcasting to supporting this franchise. And they have given back to us and given us these incredible opportunities. And then Ryan Dole,
I can't stand the fan base. I can't stand the franchise. I can't, you know,
I'm not letting you do it.
Oh, come on.
Or not you admit it, maybe the biggest Ghostbusters fan I know, the most passionate diehard Ghostbusters fan I know, and you have spent the better half of the last year, or actually almost exactly a year,
almost
working on Ghostbusters Frozen Empire.
Yeah. And that was, well, it was fun for me. I had a blast.
Yeah.
I had, right? Like, it was just, I don't know. It's cool. It was interesting seeing how that particular sausage got made.
Yeah.
You know, and then what we saw in theater and that kind of stuff. But I had a blast working on it. You know, I had a blast watching it. You don't get that all the time when you're working on live action movies.
Well, Ryan, I don't want to put you on the spot, but your IMDb is impressive. You have worked on some of the most popular and biggest grossing movies of the last decade.
Morbius.
And you're known for Morbius.
Yeah,
it's Morbin time.
Morbin time. Yeah.
It is Morbin time.
That's
by the way,
secret cap. He's always Morbin.
I had this thought today that it just dawned on me. I definitely, when I was a kid, thought Billy Corgan and Zordon were the same person.
Oh my God. I
just want to put that out there.
Despite all my rage, I am still just a head in a tank.
Yeah. Okay, listen. Right now, Ryan, for those who don't know, you are you're on the VFX side. You are a production coordinator on this film. Can you just give a high level of what that is?
I put cats in boxes. I make sure deadlines are, I make sure deadlines are met. I schedule, I do a lot of one-on-one artist check-ins to make sure nobody's getting burnt out and dying.
Sure.
That kind of thing. That's usually kind of like, you know, and just, that's really, and just making sure all the right versions of shots are getting to the right people in the pipeline. And then I had the special job on this particular film being keeper of the lore. So when things, they didn't quite like, is this work in the Ghostbusters universe? That's where I would get called into meetings. Let's just double check with Dole. So there would be
Dole, so, double check.
Yeah. Hey, Dole, can we have you hop into this meeting right now just for a quick review? Thank you.
The Dole check.
Yeah, right. So there was a lot of that happening too. That's what I think made this film extra special to work on for me, because I was brought in a lot to just be like, hey, does this work? Where is this from? If this happens, what would be the reaction with this for this? Can't get into the specifics of what that is yet.
Sure.
But we can in the future at some point.
In time.
And then, you know, a couple of the one thing I can bring up, one thing I can talk about.
Let's do it.
That so when we were doing the proton streams and stuff early on, I have like one of the old 80s magazines. Why is the name escaping me? Like a
Starlog.
Yes. Yep. And they had the whole VFX breakdown from 84 in there, explaining this was the look. This is how we wanted it to look. So they had the whole breakdowns of the proton streams, because they kept saying, make it look like 84. And I kept saying, but that doesn't look like 84. And they said, well, what do you mean? And I said, well, this is how proton streams work. They go into the proton wand, not out of the proton wand. Orange goes in, blue comes out, because they wrangle the ghosts in. So if you watch and hear that, I started doing scans of the magazine where they were like explaining all of that and how they made it look that way. Then we went to match that, and then we pitched it, and they said, does that look like Afterlife? And we went, well, Afterlife is technically wrong. and so we fixed the proton stream problem. For all of you that noticed, because I'm certain 50 of you that are here watching us, I'm sure you did. So.
No, but that was such a nerdy conversation we just had.
Well, that's what the show streams. Is.
This is some nerdy shit. I like it though.
Right? It was fun.
You did great, guys. Ryan.
Like I said, Ryan, that is great insight. And God damn it. What the fuck is going on? Sorry.
Oh,
people are calling me. Don't they know I'm in the middle of a stream?
It's because those panels are happening right now at WonderCon and everyone's losing their mind.
Maybe I don't like, for some reason my computer rings now when my phone rings.
Somebody wait, do you have, is everything Apple?
Yeah,
that's somebody probably why.
Turn it all off. Yeah, it's annoying. Anyways, sorry. Random outbursts from Craig getting over being sick this week. Okay,
yeah.
Let's just put it out there. Okay, so we're gonna get into some Ghostbusters Frozen Empire talk. There's a lot of people already in the chat, a lot of people giving some opinions. We just had a super chat, thank you so much, from Alex Colster. We appreciate that. So let's go ahead and say hi to the chat for the folks who are here, and we're gonna dive into some opinions. Listen, I do want to say this. I think that there's some common themes and some trends I'm seeing with this movie. The one trend that I am seeing that I have also experienced, because I've now seen the movie 3 times, is that it gets significantly more enjoyable with each viewing. And I think this is something that, if you're a hardcore fan, I know this happened to me with The Force Awakens. It happened to me with any movie where I'm anticipating it so much. You almost can't, your brain, you've done all of your, whether or not you admit it, you do all your own fan fiction in your head, or if you're John, you've written it all out.
As Jacob said, I wrote this movie in a dream. So
yeah. I know with me, each viewing has gotten better. My third viewing, I was way more emotional. I'll get into some of the reasons behind that. We'll break it all down. So should we say hi to the chat though?
Yeah,
sure.
Do it. Jason, Sarah Smith is here. Jason DeLine, new name. So I'm going to get some of these wrong. Ryan S. Riken Brickwallen is here. Brock Parker on the air. Tony Taylor, Alex Colster, Soul of the Mind, Ray Death Ray, Ghostbusters fan 64513. All right. Ghostbusters collector is here. Real RoboCop art. Jermaine Williams. Who else do we got? AJ Quick. Who we'll talk about in just a moment because we adore him. Andy Sparks. Steve Mandville. Lots of new names tonight. Andrew Bundy, Paul Rossiter. Thank you guys all for being here. We appreciate it. If we don't mention your name, don't take it personally. We just there's a lot of people here, so we appreciate it. Okay. I mentioned AJ Quick. He was with us in New York. Everybody needs to go check out gbfans.com. If you're here, you probably already know about GB Fans, but I know I have this sudden urge to listen. My first couple years as a fan, I was putting together flight suits and building proton packs. And then, you know, I matured. Okay. I said, I have to start a podcast.
Oh, I thought you were going to say I bought a HasLab. I matured. I bought a HasLab. My back got weaker. Built packs are for strong backs.
There you go.
Right.
But
has
we love
grown, not has been, right? That's how we do it.
We love AJ. And if you guys want to build a proton pack or just find a community.
Yeah. Also, do build a proton pack.
Do you build a proton pack.
GBFans.com.
Yes. We love that. So, okay. More on that later. But really, AJ brought together an entire community of people through the GB Fans forums. And I met so many of my friends through this community. And that's really the reason why we do all of this. The reason why we spend so much time and spend so much energy and money is because we love it. As I always say, YHS is a for-profit business. We're just still waiting to do that.
It's like Raise a Cult.
It is. We are the Raise a Cult of podcasts. And we work there now. Let's go to some comments. Well, maybe we can let some of the comments lead the discussion. We'll get into it.
Sure.
All right, here we go. First comment that I saw, I just wanted to address real quick because they're coming in. By the way, guys, listen, don't argue in the chat because I get distracted trying to read all the tea. Like take it offline. But listen, there's always going to be strong opinions with these movies, right, Ryan? Like anytime there's fandom involved, not everything is made for everybody.
No. Yeah. And it's definitely not made for a bunch of like 30-year-olds and up. Like first
said the 30-year-olds and up.
Hey, you know what? Straight up.
I'm 40 and up now.
As someone who works in the business, let me tell you, according to studio execs, you're already 1 foot in the casket. Yeah. They're looking for the younger demographics.
Yeah.
Sometimes it's like we're lucky when something like Frozen Empire comes out where a majority of the fans dig it.
Yeah.
Like, dig it. Where there's fan service for us, you know, all that kind of stuff. Like it's rare we get that kind of stuff. So that kind of appeals to kind of both. And I feel that studios are more and more starting to find that balance.
Yeah.
But like we still got, there's still a lot of studios that are just like, they're trying to get that, the teenagers, because the teenagers are the ones that they still see teenagers as the ones that go to movies. Yeah. Because now everybody our age, we stay home and we stream.
Right. Yeah.
Right. So even with that, with the studios even thinking that direction, it's just like, even if they were trying to appeal to just the Ghostbusters fans, I've known the Ghostbusters fan community long enough that none of them are happy. And no matter what you give them, they will regurgitate some of the most vile shit you've ever read online.
Well,
about anything.
Sure. A couple things before we go any further. I can't find the comments. Somebody asked if Abby was okay. She's okay. I promise you. Jacob's okay. Jacob's in the chat. I think there's some loud voices that always like to make themselves heard, but I haven't been digging on, you know, every message board and every Facebook group because my mental health is way more important.
Because you believe in self-care.
Because I believe in self-care. But John, to me, the general fan reaction has been pretty positive. I mean, he's in some ways more positive than Afterlife. Like,
Yeah. It's interesting because I think that, and you've heard, you know, Kumail said it, Gil has said it, a lot of people have said it, you know, this film really gets that real Ghostbusters kind of tone, like real Ghostbusters at its best had that perfect balance of funny stuff, creepy stuff. It felt like a mystery action adventure. And it just, you know, they were always coming up with new gadgets and there was new bad guys expanding the lore and all that kind of stuff. And I feel like they found the secret sauce and the stuff that made that work in the cartoon and brought it into the movie world. And I think that for fans, like that was our bread and butter. Like if you look at it comparatively, and this is not to make the film sound unimportant or anything, but we, up until Afterlife, you know, we had only gotten two films that were about Ray, Egon, Winston, and Peter and Janine, but we got seven seasons of an animated series. So no matter how much we want to talk about how much we love the movies, that seven seasons of Ghostbusters, quality notwithstanding, toward the end, that cemented what Ghostbusters was for so many of us. And so seeing some of that brought into the films, you know, and tonally and everything, and some of the different things it did to us, it was like, oh, wow, this is it. Like, this is what Ghostbusters is to us. And I think for people that are kind of outside the fandom and maybe didn't really watch the cartoon, some of them maybe didn't even know there was a cartoon, it's not that for us, we see the clear, like, starting at Ghostbusters 1 and getting into the real Ghostbusters, how it all connects and it all feels like it forms this cohesive, like, this is what Ghostbusters is to us. But just by virtue of it being a cartoon, like so many other shows like Beetlejuice and RoboCop and all the other stuff that got cartoons based off movies that were probably not exactly meant for kids, there is a little bit of a change, even if the concept and the characters stay the same when you make that transition to animation. So growing up, it all blends into one for us. But if you didn't have that experience, you're looking at Ghostbusters 1 and some of the raunchier jokes and some of the more adult stuff in there. And then you're seeing this kind of little bit cartoonier flavor be injected into it that makes it a little more family friendly and a little less just, you know, dry comedy and a little more action adventure and spooky and everything. And you're like, why is this what they're doing? When to the fans, it's like, this makes complete sense. This is perfect.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, no, I agree with that. Cause I find a lot of people that say they love Ghostbusters, but didn't enjoy this movie. They want it to be more like the first movie.
Yeah. They're the people who are like, oh, we should have got Ghostbusters 3 with Seth Rogen and all these other people. Well, it should have been a raunchy comedy. And it's not that that might not have been good, but it's not, you know, it's not what real Ghostbusters was necessarily.
So I think this taps in, by the way, I love this image of Winston and Ray. And I really think the Ray stance storyline in this movie is so good.
So good.
Yep. And kind of understated, and really, I mean, Dan Aykroyd giving his most significant acting performance in a very long time.
Yeah.
But
side note real quick, when he has that line where he talks about, like, this is how I want to spend my golden years, that is pure real Ghostbusters, because we never got old Ray in real Ghostbusters, but there were whole episodes dedicated to Ray missing the good old days and missing, you know, how hectic it was when they first started Ghostbusters and all this other stuff, and wishing that they could have these big adventures again instead of mundane, like, oh, it's another class five. So hearing him say that is like, that's Ray. Like, it clicks.
Winston tells him to shut up. Shut up, Ray. God, they probably all wanted to say that for so long. Ray, just shut up. We as a baseline, we all know Ghostbusters means different things to different people, and that's what happens when a franchise becomes generational, right?
Yeah,
there are, to some people, Star Wars is A New Hope. To some people, Star Wars is the best Star Wars movie is Revenge of the Sith, or the best Star Wars content ever is the Clone Wars. So the longer something exists and the more iterations there are of it, the more, you know, the fan base grows, but also the more varied opinions of what it quote unquote is are out there. There's an entire generation of people who were between 15 and 25 when the first Ghostbusters movie came out, and it was the greatest comedy of all time, right? That is great. That's not a wrong opinion.
No,
there are people that are a little bit more in our age bracket who were very young or not even born when the first movie came out. And by time GB2 and Real Ghostbusters were rolling, that was our generation, right? Like,
yeah.
Hollywood Reporter last week had an article, the top all the Ghostbusters movies ranked. And for the first time ever, a major publication straight up was like, Ghostbusters 2 is the best Ghostbusters movie. And like, it wasn't like a troll job or a this is the Hollywood Reporter. Yeah. So I do think that
the person was also 30 years old that wrote it.
Well,
case in point, that's exactly what I mean. Talking about.
Yes, but that's what I mean.
Right. Yeah. So, and when we were on the red carpet and that little kid, Chase, the 7-year-old kid, we asked him, I said, well, what's your favorite Ghostbusters movie? And he goes, well, do you mean besides ones that have Phoebe and Trevor in it? And it was like, oh. By the way, he had already seen Frozen Empire. He got an advanced screening.
Oh, that's cool.
So
little bastard.
Son of a bitch. So what it is that it's almost impossible to make a movie that's going to appeal to everybody, right?
Yeah.
Right. There's a whole subset of Ghostbusters fans who just don't want more movies because they want to leave it where it was and that's it. And then there's people who want to expand it and
That's a pretty shitty way to view it. Here,
well, like, I mean, I didn't say that. That's a good opinion. I'm just saying.
Like the idea of giving that set, like that, the kid. What's the kid's name again? I feel like such a jerk.
Chase.
The fact that he's the child. That he was like totally like my favorite one outside of like Phoebe and Trevor. This already shows me that, and I'm hoping that the franchise now can live through like for another generation through these characters. Cause that's how really this stuff lives on. It doesn't live on. It lives on through us, hopefully passing it down in a way, but like, and Ghostbusters 1, like when that kid's older, he's going to be like, whoa, Ghostbusters 1 is awesome.
Right.
Yeah. Yeah.
Right. But for kids right now, I think I think a lot of people even said in the chat already too, like they saw it with their kids loved it. I loved it. You know, like, I think
part of the issue that I'll let you guys all talk on this stuff, because this is what I've been thinking about a lot lately. The time to capitalize on nostalgia is usually 20 years after the original thing, right? Mm-hmm. Jurassic World came out 21 years after Jurassic Park and was insanely huge because it was right in that pocket of everybody going, I am ready for dinosaurs again.
Yeah.
Truth be told, because of all the stuff we've been talking about for years and years, Ghostbusters missed their peak nostalgia window. If Ghostbusters 3 with the original cast and newcomers would have come out in 2006 or 2007, it would have been massive on massive on massive. It just would have been.
Yeah.
Right? It was Bill Murray at the peak of his dramatic acting talents. He would have gone back to Ghostbusters, Harold Ramis, all that stuff. But it didn't happen.
Yeah.
And so by time we get to Answer the Call, that's a whole thing.
By time I think even if, and this is not to like, you know, dig up old memories or make a big thing out of it, but even if something like Afterlife had been what came out in 2016, I still think we would have been able to catch the tail end of like, ooh, and here's one more really good nostalgia legacy movie kind of thing. Not that it wasn't that, but you know.
All that to be said, I adore Afterlife and I love this movie and I can't wait to keep watching it. I don't think this movie is as far off from the tone of the original Ghostbusters movies as people think it is in their head. Like if you watch it, if you pay attention to the subtleties of the character, like Jason Reitman and Gil Kenan have injected a level of like humanity and you know, coming of age isms into Ghostbusters that they're just not there in the first two movies, right? There's some sweet moments between Peter and Dana in the second movie, but this is literally a movie where you have Ray and Winston contemplating their own mortality and their own age and what their purpose is. And you have Phoebe being, you know, essentially disregarded by her family for reasons that are beyond their control and her not being able to connect with anybody and finding companionship in Melody. And so these are pretty big themes that they're trying to pack into in an hour and 45 minutes. So it is a lot to take in.
Yeah.
All right. Well, we're done. I've said my piece, but we're not done.
Yeah. I think you're entirely right. I think that it's something I've said for the longest time, and I remember people used to look at me weird for it, but I've always said, like, Ghostbusters is a comedy, but Ghostbusters being remembered as a comedy might be the thing that has hurt it the most, because then every time somebody has tried to reapproach it since Ghostbusters 2, Dan's going to do what Dan does. And when he's coming up with Ghostbusters 3 ideas and all that, his brain is still firmly in the same place it was with Ghostbusters 1 and Ghostbusters 2 in terms of lore and jargon and all that kind of stuff. But I think the studio increasingly was like, well, then we got to get comedy people. We got to get comedy people. But I think the trick is that you, whether it was Jason or someone else, you were going to need someone who was like, comedy can only be as good as the story is. And I think throughout the 2000s, we had some really good comedies, but they were comedy first movies. And that's okay. And that's a certain type of movie. And those movies are really enjoyable. But I think Ghostbusters has always had that level of like, but if you took out all the jokes, it would be a totally different movie. And I'm not advocating for anyone to make a humorless Ghostbusters, but there's still a level of like, this is a coherent story and a really cool concept. And you've got to be able to service those things in addition to the humor.
Ryan, no, I agree with everything you just said, John. Ryan, I want you to speak to this a little bit as somebody who worked on the movie. Anybody can be critical of anything. Like, we all have... Do I think some critics love going after Ghostbusters for... I don't like saying they have an agenda, because that's like such a internet painting a broad stroke. But do I think some people go, ooh, they're still trying to do this Ghostbusters thing. I can't wait to pan this thing. Of course that exists. Of course.
Oh, I think we're in this state that feels like for the last couple of years where it's just like, if it's a franchise.
Right. If it's,
they want to go after it.
This is one thing I've been getting frustrated when people say, oh, this is a movie by committee and it's a soulless friend. Like, listen, we know these people. These people fucking care. There is so much passion for this franchise. Listen, they know. Sony knows this is not going to be a $300-400 million movie. They want it to be, but they trust that Jason and Gil are going to make a good story.
Sorry, John, one second.
Yeah.
When it comes down to the making money part too, they also know they're not going to make that money from China. So there's some international money too that they're not going to make, because they can't release this movie in China.
They cannot release this movie in China.
Right? That's where a lot of money, like when they made this much money worldwide. Like, how do you think Aquaman made $1 billion? It wasn't in the United States.
No, it
right?
was not.
So, I mean, so because of that, you got to take, they already are taking that chunk out, which is why they looked at the Afterlife numbers and were like, we can still make another movie.
Yeah.
And I have a feeling too that even when this is done, and let's say they don't green light a third movie right away, if it does insanely well in streaming or even like Blu-ray sales, which I know is getting harder and harder to do now because now stores are stop carrying the 4Ks and steel cases and stuff. But I think if it even does really well in streaming after, they can still go, there's an audience here.
Yeah.
Well, that's the thing. Everybody's a box office analyst online, and everybody's knows exactly how movie budgets work.
Yeah. Everyone's an armchair studio executive.
Yeah. Everyone's like, well, everybody knows that the budget was this and marketing is at least, it's like, you literally just don't know.
They don't.
All marketing and all real quick, John, I'll go to you.
All
marketing budgets are behind closed doors and they are factored in across all movies being released in a calendar year. And here's another thing. They are not in the business of losing money. Okay. Yeah. It's why the WB, Warner. It's why Warner Brothers.
Michigan J Frog.
It's why Michigan J Frog has been like control alt ribbiting new whole ass movies.
Wow. That was impressive. That was amazing.
So was good. When you have a movie that has $100 million budget, that is shooting in the UK, that is likely offset by major tax credits, they might get 20 to 30% back off the top just for shooting in the UK.
Yeah.
Right.
And when it's all said and done, is this going to be a massive, massive financial gain for Sony? Maybe not, but I don't think it's, I saw some people in the chat saying, oh, King Kong came in and destroyed. Listen, Kong and Godzilla, you cannot argue with Legendary's rollout of their friend. They have, I think there's some, I don't know. There's a lot to unpack, but John, just go for it.
Yeah, no, I mean, is a couple things. I mean, speaking to what you just talked about, it's, you know, you've got to also remember that Sony, like Ghostcore, is in charge of Ghostbusters. And I think this is something I'm really interested to see how it plays out with James Gunn being in charge of DC Studios. Because I feel like when you have a situation where you've got a studio within a studio and that studio is run by people who genuinely love whatever that studio is in charge of, there's a level of like, hey, internally, we can assure certain levels of quality and we understand the franchise or the brand that we're handling. So even if big studio has demands, we can look at it and say, well, we know the franchise. How can we try to fit that in there, but do it in a way that feels right?
Sure.
And I think that, you know, then they get to turn around and hand like a coherent product in terms of like the concept or whatever level the studio wants to hear from and say, this is what we've got. Will you, you know, release the funding or whatever? But then you've also, so yeah, when people talk about like, oh, this is made by committee, it's like there's literally a studio whose job it is to just make Ghostbusters movies.
Right.
And if that committee is full of people who are in love with Ghostbusters, then yeah, you might be right. But it's
it's hard. You know, it's hard because Sony also put out Madam Web this year.
But that's what I was going to say. You have to look at, even though Ghostcore is handling Ghostbusters, Sony is still trying to make their bottom line, and Ghostbusters is a piece of that. So if they're right, like, oh no, Madam Web, oh no this, oh no that, we've got to worry about X, Y, and Z.
Right.
Suddenly the Ghostbusters might come under a little more scrutiny or have a little more pressure on it.
Yeah. We have a super chat from BC DeLorean and other movie cars. I love the film. 4 stars and a heart on Letterboxd. Ghost and ghost busting is really all I needed. Yeah. Fuck yeah. Thank you, Brandon. We appreciate that. Let's go to the chat. Paul says, I drove to Shinfield Studios when they were shooting and parked outside. I knew I couldn't go in, but I just like to be able to say I was there. Yeah, that's awesome.
Kind of. I like that. I mean, at the end.
And let's see if there's another one we can highlight. Mr. Michael T, in an article Jason Reitman mentioned, he stepped back from directing Frozen Empire because he was in mourning and made the call to only produce and co-write. Yeah,
totally understandable.
100% understandable. This is,
but Gil Cannon. Still very involved.
He's very involved.
Yeah.
Very involved. Just like Ivan was with Afterlife. Like, that's a producer's role, is to get it.
Yeah.
All aspects of it over the finish line. So Christopher Bouchard, yes, we know about the Hasbro reveal today. They're doing O-ring style, G.I. Joe style Ghostbusters figures. We are going to be breaking all of that down on Toy Anxiety this week. And we'll hopefully get some more clear images and stuff. Pretty cool stuff, but we will.
We'll be pre-ordering in June. So we're good.
We'll be pre-ordering on Ghostbusters Day. Riken says, I feel like Dan Aykroyd's comment about more Ghostbusters is up to the fans. Makes me feel Sony has already greenlit whatever they decide to do. I mean, again, there's so much that happens behind the scenes that we just don't know about.
Yeah.
Like, I don't think it's... Here's an exercise for everybody. We've been trained as a society to think in a very binary way, black or white. Was it good? Was it bad? Was it a flop? Was it successful? Is there a sequel plan? Isn't there? And the truth is, it's all gray area.
Yeah.
Sony might not make a financial call on what the next, you know, movie project is for a year. They might say, let's let the dust settle. Let's see where the streaming rights land. Let's see what kind of recoup we do with home video. Let's see. And also all the promotions, like, guys, Cheetos, Icy, booking.com, Mercedes, American Express.
Yep.
I think they all pay a lot of money to be part of this.
I literally cannot watch YouTube videos without seeing the Liberty Mutual commercial with all the mini puffs.
Liberty, right. Liberty, Liberty. See, I'm doing the song. It's working.
But what's crazy is Welch's did not, and they're all over that Slimer garbage.
Thank you, Paul. We will see you next time. Appreciate you being here. And listen, there's
did you guys try those ghost pepper Cheetos, by the way?
No, I was told they were spicy, and I got scared.
Oh, dude, you should be. I was eating them. I was like, these aren't that bad. Four in, and I'm like, Oh no. Oh yeah. No. What have I done?
I do want to be Chester Cheetah as a Ghostbuster for.
Is that your Dragon Con costume?
No, that's what I'm going to do for the next Paul Abdul video.
I was like, so you're going to do a furry dressed as by the way, no judgment to furries out there.
No.
That's your thing.
Teach their own.
Teach their own. I'm not going to yuck anyone's yums.
No.
Right? We don't do that here as Ghostbusters fans.
guys, again, I don't want to highlight. Listen, if you're just going to be here in the chat and just be negative, I don't know what to tell you. Like, don't be here. Like, we're just trying to have some thoughtful discussion. That's all.
Yeah. I think that's something. God, that's a lesson I wish the entire internet could learn. Just because you did not like something, or even if you did like something, it is not your job necessarily to go into a space and convince everybody else that your opinion is the right one.
No, because everything is skewed. I want to highlight Jake's comment here. Everything's skewed by opinion. Like, even last week at 45 million box office, one article, Ghostbusters thaws out the box office with huge opening. Next article, Ghostbusters falls short with disappointing opening.
Mm-hmm.
What is it? Nobody knows.
Yeah, Jake's comment is 100% on point. And let me tell
you
what.
Craig, let's read it first.
John,
you can read.
Okay. Yeah. It says the problem is that people let their headcanon and what they wish was in the movie control them, and it keeps them from being objective. Craig, let me ask you this. In the lead up to Afterlife, how many messages did you and I exchange where I went on for paragraphs describing what I thought the plot of the movie was going to be and how excited I was about it?
I mean, I just said, let it flow, man.
Talk. And we were getting ridiculous. At one point I was like, what if it's revealed that Egon is related to Tobin or some craziness that I got really into for a minute. But what did I do when it was time to sit down and watch Afterlife? I checked all of those bags full of ideas at the door because the movie's not mine. I did not need it to be what I thought it was going to be, because at that point I'm just a fan and I'm letting it wash over me, because I'm here for Ghostbusters, not for me to feel like I got it right.
Right.
If I got anything right, cool. Yeah. That's great. But if not, it doesn't matter. I didn't make this movie.
But I was excited for John specifically in this movie, because there's definitely a couple. Let's get into some of this.
There was some Yerkeva-isms, 100%.
By the way, hey, spoilers coming up. Yeah, spoilers. If you didn't know. Opening this movie in 1904 at the Manhattan Adventurer Society. That sounds like a John Yerkeva thing.
100%.
Yeah.
100%.
There's a bunch of stuff in here. And let me put this out up front. No part of me thinks that any of this was stolen or any weird. Like, to me, this is the kind of thing where, like, it's the kind of thing where, like, to me, and I've always felt this, whether it was somehow going to be me doing it or someone else, there is a direction that it feels like it would be really cool for Ghostbusters to go in. And a lot of the things that are in this movie that we're talking about, like, oh, this feels like a John thing, it's just Ghostbusters going in that direction. So stuff like the Paranormal Research Center and new uniforms for a new division of Ghostbusters that specialize in a certain thing, and upgrading proton packs and new vehicles and flashbacks to the past to establish the bad guy. And
Grandma's sex dungeon. That's a very John.
Yes, that's exactly. But all of that stuff, like, that's the kind of stuff I tell the story all the time. When I was a kid pretending to be a Ghostbuster with my little Kenner proton pack, I was never pretending to be, you know, Egon or Winston or whoever. I was me, and I had my own team, and I reported back to headquarters, and I would always daydream about, like, ooh, if it was real, what would it be like when I'm old enough to be a Ghostbuster? How will things have changed? Will there be this? Will there be that? So seeing everything on film go in that direction and explore those things, like, my head's been living in that space since I was like 4. And
that's also very real Ghostbusters in the sense that they were always exploring the past and, like, the different side characters that would help them out. And that's, I mean, that's when we visited, by the way, I want to real quick highlight Mr. Michael T. He said, thanks for getting a shot of the painting. We have the Wonderverse mystery painting solved. Yeah. So basically at Wonderverse in Chicago, there's this portrait of young up and coming explorer, part of the Manhattan Adventure Society.
Oh my God. Is that, stop it. Oh my God. Now I want to write that story. Oh my
Evo God. Shandor.
My brain is on fire right now. What was funny is,
when we walked into that, you could see that it's not really seen in the movie, but it's in our behind the scenes video.
Yeah.
What was hilarious is when we walked, I wish Jacob was here to tell the story. We walked in and we're just like, we've been on set for 10 minutes and we're literally freaking out and losing our minds and trying to like play it cool. And Jake looks at this painting and goes, why is there a picture of J.K. Simmons on the wall?
Oh my God, without clicking?
Yeah, and I was like, oh, yeah.
Right.
Like, it was like, boom, boom, boom.
But that's like, I love that stuff so much. And it's exactly what Jason talked about in one of the videos from what's his name? The guy.
Adam Savage?
Adam Savage videos, where he was talking about the kind of like lore and continuity and Easter eggs and stuff that it's not about the camera focusing on it. So you have a moment to go, hey, I know that. It's just, it's right there. And it's, if you see there it and you know it, you're like, oh, but if not, it doesn't break the movie. It doesn't do right anything. And maybe you see it on the second time you see it or something. So that kind of like, oh yeah, Shandor was in the Adventurers Club is like, and you just feel the yeah depth of like how well thought out the world is.
Described by Patton Oswalt's character as yeah a bunch of rich assholes.
It's yeah it, dude. And he, the other thing I loved is that like Patton Oswalt totally fits the mold of like so many of the characters they got help from in real Ghostbusters, but mm-hmm also the Adventure Society like is a, it's such a Lovecraftian like, oh, here's a literally a bunch of rich assholes who thought we can dabble in the unknown. We're going to be fine. And then they're totally not fine. Like ever. That is, it's perfect.
Yeah. Right. Like I'm guessing that Evo Shandor left to go hang out in Oklahoma.
Yeah, he probably joined up with him and then was like, they don't get it. And then went off to do his own thing. And then they got frozen. Like, it's so,
So
this is the kind of stuff that I'm like, do more of this, Ghostbusters. I love it.
Michael Tanaka, I didn't know that was supposed to be Evo Shandor. Who told you that? So here's the deal. Nobody has come out. I don't think anybody while we were there confirmed. We just both recognized it as J.K. Simmons.
Yeah.
And why would they hang up that random ass picture at Wonderverse in Chicago next to Vigo? Yeah. Like, it just, to me, listen, is there a small chance that like we're all taking crazy leaps? Maybe. And I'll try to confirm it. I don't know with who. Oh, probably. Yeah. We've got some cool stuff coming up. You guys stay tuned to the channel. Make sure you're subscribed. We can ask these kinds of questions.
I like that. Oh wait, there is someone.
Oh yeah, Jacob says it was confirmed. And one of the, here's another fun fact. I think one of the other paintings we highlighted in our video was Gil Cannon's dad.
Nice.
So part of, I like what you guys are saying, part of the set deck is that it's just there and it's not necessarily yeah here's a close-up shot, get it, wink wink. Hey Ryan, I want to talk about Kumail Nanjiani.
Yes.
And his character of Nadim.
Mm-hmm.
When we visited set, we first heard about this, all we were like, well, this is a swing. this is going to be, you know, I have full faith in these writers and directors, and I find Kumail to be incredibly talented. And if you've never seen The Big Sick, gifted writer, gifted comedian, amazing, you know, stuff.
Great in Obi-Wan Kenobi.
Yeah, he was great.
But this is a new thing. Not necessarily, like, we've seen human characters become possessed in Ghostbusters movies and wield various powers. We saw Janosch flying around the city with a baby carriage. never quite understood his pilgrim outfit, but that's for another day. Mr. Dole, what did you think of the addition to Nadim and that storyline?
Maybe I'm biased or whatever, but I was all for it. This is all stuff they hint at throughout the series. And I feel anyway, like this is why they're always testing people. Mm-hmm. And like, you're right. We've seen possession and all that. So the idea of having people that have enchanted armor and are able to do enchanted skills, like they even ask, like, do you believe in ESP? Do you believe in this? Do you believe in that? When, you know, so this is all stuff they all dabble in and have looked into, and have clearly there have been cases in the past of all this stuff existing.
Yeah.
So to me, for the Ghostbusters world, that makes perfect sense that this would, if ghosts exist, and you've got demons that exists and parallel dimensions and everything else and cross rips, why not?
Yeah.
So, I'm all for it.
100%. The first thing it made me think of again was real Ghostbusters and how, you know, one of the episodes that is the most highly praised, it's like every fan's favorite episode, is the Cthulhu episode. And they team up with someone who can cast spells. And it's right there. And then the other thing it reminded me of was the episode where Winston discovers he's like the distant, you know, descendant of the, you know, Shimabuku African warrior. And literally a very similar thing happens to Winston in that episode. So to me, it's like, oh, of course. Yeah, right. This is a thing.
Yep.
And I thought it was really cool that they were able to. Oh, that's cool. Maybe I'll be able to share that. They were able to tell a meaningful story, right? Like, I don't think you're going to have Jason Reitman and Gil Kenan telling these stories without some real depth. Yeah. And you have a kid or guy who's not really doing much with his life, who literally is part of a lineage of ancient warriors who trapped Garaka in this orb in the back room.
Yeah.
And he has to kind of come to terms with that, and he's scared. But it's played for laughs mostly. They didn't go. I think the heavier story is the Phoebe Melody story, and I want to get into that too, because there is a lot to unpack. There's a lot of characters in this movie. There's a lot of interwoven storylines, but I mean, I think they pulled it off. Like, if you're just watching all the commercial spots and going, "There's so much," they cut so much. It's like, just chill. That's not you're not
every movie does. You're not watching movies the right way.
I think the thing, and this goes back to some of the stuff we were talking about earlier, everybody wants to have this like shorthand or code or immediate signal of like, is a movie good or bad? And I think when people see that there's stuff that got cut from trailers or they hear that there was reshoots, they want to immediately categorize it as must be bad. They didn't get it right the first time. They cut stuff out. They had to reshoot. And it's like, no, that's part of the process. Literally, like, that's how movies work.
Also, I'm gonna make a YouTube video. I'm gonna make a YouTube video called "What is a Plot Hole?" Because people like to use the word plot hole at like they're like, why didn't Phoebe's pack do this at the end? Plot hole. Well, what the fuck? It's not a guys. I watched Multiplicity last night. He clones himself four times, and you just accept it.
Yeah.
And it's also the judge from Ghostbusters 2 doing it. Like, you just, like, there are leaps of faith and leaps of logic in a, especially a movie like this. Like, we're not.
Yeah.
You can't just say plot hole.
You can't. Hey,
yeah.
Just a heads up for everyone, too. Like, reshoots are every part of every movie. They're part of the budget. They're part of the shooting schedule, the whole bit.
Yep.
Each first cut of the movie is like 3 to 4 hours long.
Yeah.
Most of the time.
And that's then, at the level when you start looking at, okay, what do we want to put in the trailer? So of course you're going to lose stuff potentially.
Correct. And things are just going to get cut. Things are going to get trimmed down to just make things move faster, to keep the pace going. There's a lot that happens in that editing room. You know, you're always going to get new sequences, new versions of sequences, updated sequences, new shots, loose shots, right? That's just how movies get made. And I think just a lot of people don't know that. I clearly didn't understand that when I first started. Then once I started working into film and you start seeing how the, you know, like I said, how the sausage gets made, you're just like, got it. Okay.
Yeah.
It's like, so the other thing that Ivan talked about and Jason talked about, movie making is an iterative process, and I think we are in this time period, especially with Ghostbusters, we waited so long that people feel like they're being shortchanged. Gil Kenan was asked recently, will we get deleted scenes on the Blu-ray? He's like, yeah, we will. Perfect. Will there be a director's cut? No. People have this entitlement, like, I saw something in the trailer that wasn't in the movie. You owe that to me.
Yeah, they want a cause that they can feel like they are on the right side of history with. So if there's a deleted scene and then the director admits there's a deleted scene, they feel like it's their duty to get on Twitter and say, release the director's cut. And it's like, dude, calm down. Like, no, what are you doing? It's not, just chill. Well,
for instance, by the way, I like this comment from Real RoboCop Art. The ability to be objective and have constructive dialogue has been irreparably damaged by social media. I love YHSGB, the community, when people can simply agree to disagree. Just smile. I love it. Thank you.
Yeah, 100%.
Civil discord, I believe it's what it's called.
Afterlife, right? There was an interview this week with Annie Potts. She was like, I was basically left on the cutting room floor of Afterlife, right? And she was like, I wanted to come back and do Frozen Empire, but I told them, like, give me something to do. Yeah. So they're like, okay, be a Ghostbuster. But I think Afterlife, a director's cut of Afterlife, it's a there's a very different movie in there. And they don't know that going into it. It's like a painting. It's like any piece of art. And people also forget this is an art form. Movie making, writing, directing, editing. And God,
I wish when people, anytime someone has ever seen me post a picture and said, man, that's really cool, I wish you could see all of the different sketches and all of the changing that it goes through, but before it gets to you, because there are definitely times where it's like, that was a completely different picture to begin with.
Right. Hey, also people who with a straight face say that they're mad that the Red Jackets were not in the movie.
I don't get it. I don't understand the anger because it's still in the movie. It's still a part of the official Ghostbusters uniform issued clothing ensemble. So it's not like you ended up with something that doesn't even matter. It's a thing.
But it's still like this notion. It's in the movie. It's in the movie. And like, that's not, I guess I'm just like, I love all the props and I love the proton pack, the PKE meter and the jackets and the uniforms and all that. But like, if you go into a movie going, they owe me this because my plan was to go to DragonCon and put on a red jacket.
Like, did people think it was going to be like in a Batman movie where like halfway through the movie, his costume gets wrecked and then he comes into the final battle with a brand new one. Like the red coats were going to be their Garaka armor or something.
100% they did. And here's the funny thing. Like, people don't know this either about when we're making trailers. There are, like, you can only have a certain amount of trailer only shots, because if you have too many trailer only shots, you can actually get fined for that, for misleading.
Yeah.
Right. But there are still always like certain stingers at the end, like maybe
Paul Infinity Rudd, War is a great, you know,
yeah, example, right? Of but that. Even like that shot of the first of the trailer, right, where Paul Rudd's right with 1 foot on the ledge.
Yeah.
Right. Where's that going to fit in the film? Please, somebody tell me after watching the film, where does that fit?
Yeah.
Yeah. It doesn't.
It doesn't. Thank you, Craig.
Here's the thing. The people, like, I love it when people see that kind of stuff and then try to, like, fan fiction a way of, like, how that should have fit in the movie. And they're like, odds are it probably went between these two scenes. And I'm like, how can you? It's literally just four Ghostbusters looking off the side of a building waiting for ghosts to show up. Like, that is not a plot important shot.
Here's just the thing. Chill. By the way, I don't want to just come off like a total, you know, like,
yeah, I know.
All like a shill. But here's the deal. When I first saw that trailer, my immediate thought was, oh, that's a trailer shot.
Yeah.
Like, they probably did this for the trailer. So I've never been one of those people like, I can't wait to see that thing from the trailer in the movie. Like, you know, it's just like, whatever.
I agree.
We have a super chat. Tony Movie Chappie D9 Neil Blomkamp fan. Cool. District 9. Oh, District 9 is in his. I'll stop talking. Someone I was talking to said that Ghostbusters fans deserve better than this, and he also didn't care for Afterlife, but what is it about people getting mad over when certain... I don't know what that is. Certain films are made for fans. Oh, okay. So I think this goes into the fan service. Another thing that people just throw around. It's like when people say the word woke. Woke has now become... listen, we're not doing politics.
No.
Woke is a word that now is just, if I didn't like it, it's woke. Oh, it is,
dude,
woke. Jackets, woke.
I say this all the time. The thing that makes me the most annoyed is that people don't understand the difference between nostalgia, fan service, Easter eggs and continuity. If something is in there because it was in another movie and it is part of that world or a part of the character, it is not an Easter egg or nostalgia, or like Twinkies being an Ecto, expired Twinkies being Ecto's glove compartment. Maybe that's an Easter egg, but it's continuity because Egon couldn't stop eating them. Like, that is who he was. That just is Egon.
Proud of you then. Proud of you now.
Did you know that Twinkies are what actually killed him?
Yeah, probably. But like, it's that kind of stuff. And then people are like, oh, what? I'm tired of the fan service. And it's like, because they used a proton pack? Like, but what are you on about?
We're dealing with insanity. Guys, when we interviewed Gil Kenan on the red carpet, we did a 5-minute riff. By the way, I love doing bits. Okay. So we're finally getting to talk to the director. And all we could do is talk about how he's like, we're killing them all. Zedmore, dead. Bloodbath, Stan. And then I saw multiple people through different channels go, Gil Kenan confirmed they're killing the whole cast on the YHS show. Yeah. I was like,
they want the clickbait. They want the reaction.
What are we doing here? Oh, man.
I love it.
Mike Let's... Rita says, next week, can you guys do a positive vibe spoiler discussion?
A what?
A positive vibe? I thought we were being... Oh, I'm being...
It's fun to shit on Slender Movie for no reason, but I love to go through all the beats and talk about what we all love. Yeah, so basically tonight is... Guys, this is just a bro hang right now.
This is, yeah.
Thanks, Mike. We have some... Next week, we're going to have more streams next week. We're going to do a Q&A episode. We're going to really dig into... Guys, the movie's only been out a week. That's another thing. It's been out a week. Yeah. It's got probably another month or 6 weeks left in the theaters. There's going to be a DVD and Blu-ray release, the 40th anniversary of Ghostbusters. We're not stopping anytime soon. Let's talk before we talk about some.
Animated series in the works right now too. So
there's a Netflix animated series in the works.
Very excited.
They also announced an animated movie. There's also a new Dark Horse comic book that just dropped this week. I think a lot of people are feeling like, well, Ghostbusters is dead. It's like, just chill. It just came out a week ago.
Death chill, will ya? Just death chill out. For 1 second.
And also, like, I think you can't... People want, like... There's going to be a lot of like, well, Sony should have released it in February. Sony should release it in October. They should have got out of the way of King Kong... By the way, Kong Godzilla, they estimated 50 million this weekend. It's making 75. Good for that.
Yeah.
We have to have some objective thought about what's the turn of phrase I'm looking for where mutually exclusive. Right. Did half the world decide to go see King Kong this weekend to spite Ghostbusters to show them that there was too much fan service? Like, no, that's not what happened.
And here's how you know it's all insanity too, because you know, there are all these people who are like, oh, death to franchises. If it's getting a sequel, we hate it. But also, Godzilla is maybe the longest running franchise of all time. Mm-hmm. Like, nobody is like, people are just saying things. So, like, stop, like, ugh.
Yeah, it's true. Okay, we're going to run long a little bit. So if you guys have, like, 15 more minutes for me, that'd be amazing. I want to talk about Phoebe and Melody, and then we'll talk about the box office a little bit. Then we'll get the hell out of here, probably get a pizza. Does that sound okay?
I like that.
Pizza.
All right. By the way, thank you guys for being here. Hit the subscribe button. Hit the like button. So much more content coming from YHS over the next couple weeks. More episodes of Firehouse Fridays. We got a really special video coming in a couple weeks. I don't even want to tell you what it's called because it's heartbreaking, but I think you'll enjoy it.
If you're tired of these guys talking about all the cool shit they did, you'll love this next episode.
The main complaint about this movie, there wasn't enough podcasters in it. We're going to have some fun. So make sure you sub to the channel if you like what you see, if you like what you hear. Tell a friend. Join the Patreon. We just dropped an hour and 40-minute episode that we recorded like 2 days after we got back from London, detailing our entire visit to the set. We got a lot going on. So it's all good. Okay, Phoebe Melody. McKenna Grace, incredible actor. Emmy nominated. I mean, she's going places. She's an unbelievably kind person, very patient with the fans, been kind and supportive of us. She's done the podcast. Love Phoebe in Afterlife. I'm just going to say it. Love Phoebe in Frozen Empire. Love her story. It's funny, for years people were going, they're not, I can't believe they're just, oh, it's so unrealistic that this kid would be a Ghostbuster. First scene, Walter Peck just showed up and kicked her off the team. And then they're like,
the whole first scene is basically just Phoebe going, F you, I'm a Ghostbuster.
Yeah. And then, yeah, by the way, William Atherton was awesome in this movie.
Yeah.
Yeah. He's great.
He was really cool. So yeah, Ryan, Phoebe, Melody, let's break it down. Like, I don't think everybody here knows the storyline. She gets booted off the team. She goes out. She makes a friend. Her friend's a ghost. Her ghost has ulterior motives. We've seen the story play.
We've seen this before. Hell, some of us have even lived this.
Oh yeah. 100%. I remember one time I was hanging out with this guy for like a year. Turned out he just wanted me to unalive myself so I could use my voice to unlock Garaka's orb.
God, that's insane. I've just had women ghost me. That's how I feel. Right? So it's just, you know, so I get it, Phoebe. I get it.
All these guys are mad about the Phoebe Melody storyline. It's because they're like, they can't play chess. They don't know how. I don't either.
Wrong move. That's not a checkmate at all. It's hard. How can you not enjoy Phoebe? And I know that like Dan Aykroyd has gone on and said, like, even this is like back in like the 90s and stuff, he's always wanted to do a child genius Ghostbuster.
Yeah.
Right. So he's kind of getting what Doogie he wants Howser. In a way, right? Doogie Howser, right? James Bond Jr.
Oh my gosh.
That's twice I'm bringing that. Well, that one's
thank you for saying that, Ryan.
Yeah, you're welcome.
Speaking of James Bond Jr.,
James
A. Caster is basically like,
I remember saying this to you, Craig. I was before the movie came out, I was like, man, why do I feel like this guy's going to steal the movie? And he's not a giant part of the movie, but like I walked out of that movie being like, yo, I could do for some more Lars.
He's awesome.
Lars and all his shenanigans.
Oh yeah, like, for sure. 100%. 100%. But no.
Okay.
But yeah, to go back to like Melody and Phoebe.
Again,
it's hard not to love Phoebe. I could watch a series, a TV series of nothing but Phoebe, podcast, and Ray.
I think an animated series like that would be
would almost be ideal,
yeah,
wouldn't it?
Yeah.
But you know what? I love that. I like the stuff.
Ryan, real quick, you know what you just described, Ryan? That's literally Gravity Falls. Do Gravity Falls with Phoebe and podcast and Ray.
You're right.
It's perfect. Instead of the shack, it's Ray's a cult, and it's like, do that.
Yeah, it's just do that. But even with like Melody and stuff, I think Melody is awesome because she kind of did kind of like prey on Phoebe being down at first, and then, oh, okay, she's actually pretty cool. And then, you know, then we got the movie. But I mean, I like them. I like both of them. I like their relationship.
Well, listen,
there's all this discussion online of whether or not there was romance in bloom between Phoebe and Melody. And people 100%. Are like, of course there is. Like, very obviously, yes. And listen, you know why it's very obvious? First of all, when Melody shows up at Phoebe's bedroom window and Phoebe starts adjusting her flight suit, whoa, Joe, make sure I'm put together. My ghost friend is here. You don't do that for just a pal.
Yep.
I think when John, your camera shows up, I make sure my shirt's not wrinkled. I don't give a fuck. Okay.
Well, yeah.
Okay. Here's the thing.
Yeah.
For some reason, people get uncomfortable about this. I don't know why. It's 2024. We just got to live in the world that we live in and be like aware of our surroundings. And also, just putting this out here, every coming of age tale ever, every movie ever, there is some sort of romantic interest happening between the kids. In E.T.,
yes,
Elliot's like 10 and he's making out with that girl in his classroom. Because he's drunk.
Spoiler alert, did you know that the next Ghostbusters movie is Phoebe and Podcast trying to get laid before prom? And then Haunted Prom happens.
Haunted Prom.
That's, Ghostbusters that's, Haunted Prom.
That's a fun plot.
American Proton.
Oh man.
Ecto Pie. But in all seriousness,
Adventures in Ghostbusting.
In all seriousness, yeah. Whether or not it almost doesn't matter, right? Because the plot has to do with Phoebe entrusting somebody who betrays her trust.
Yeah.
Right. But I again, you watch it a second or third time. The stuff clicks in a way. Melody was a secret character. We didn't know who Emily Lynn was playing this entire time. So it's like you're past the point of going, oh my God. Okay. She's a ghost. What's going on here? You could just take on the story.
Yeah.
So yeah.
Yeah, no, I'm all for it. More of it.
I loved it. I thought it was
great. I'm tired of knowing that just Ray is the only person I've hooked up with a ghost. I'm tired of Ray being the only one.
Well, also, again, like it's so funny to me that this is something that now that it's in a movie, you have all these people like, no, what are they doing? Whether it's that they don't like that it's a girl or they don't like that, you know, there's this whole subplot with her as a ghost or whatever. Like, it's just like this stuff is not new territory for Ghostbusters as a franchise. And it's like even the idea of like, hey, we have a machine that could make us non-corporeal for a limited amount of time so we can, you know, do whatever. Like, think about all the times they went into the containment unit in the cartoon. Like, they had, it's the same thing. Like, calm down.
Yep. We had suits for that.
Yeah.
I can't believe we only saw them in that one episode. Gah!
Yeah.
Right. But I think I think though that You got to tell modern stories for a modern world. You got to tell the story that makes the most sense. In 1984, the EPA, the liberal, earth-saving, tree-hugging hippie EPA, they were the bad guys.
Protection agency.
They were the bad guys.
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah. And it made sense in 1984. So it's like the stories have to reflect the times. And that's an interesting thing about Afterlife, where they went to the middle of nowhere, Oklahoma, where it's like, it could be 1988. It could be 2020. Nobody knows. So, but anyways, so I really like the Phoebe Melody storyline. Could you make an argument? I think one more scene would have helped it. One more scene of them really bonding. But you can always use one more scene. Right. So it's like,
doesn't matter what it is.
I think if I was going to put one more scene in there, no, honestly, I can't think of one. I can't, like, could there have been one that would have been like, okay? Ooh, nice.
But I could think of a scene. Listen, here's what I want. Ready? Okay. If we're going to do the fan fiction.
Okay.
When Phoebe gets kicked off the team and she starts befriending Melody, I almost thought, not a Ghostbusters theme song montage, but another montage that shows a passage of time of the Ghostbusters continuing to bust, Phoebe and Melody continuing to
hang out, become friends.
Yeah, just a little bit of a passage of time.
Going on dates, chess dates, right?
I think, okay, if we can get a little bit outside of the Melody thing, if I could add one more scene, I think it would have been maybe having... Once the freezing started to set in, if there was a way to squeeze in, again, not even necessarily like theme song at full blast, but just, you know, a succession of scenes that really showed like, hey, they're out there and they're doing the work, and you see the public noticing and being like, wow, all this chaos is happening, but the Ghostbusters are out there. I think it would have made that end scene with the crowd hit a little bit harder.
Yeah. I mean, again, I think there's the movie is kind of self-contained to the firehouse at the end. It's very, and I'm okay with that because it's unique. And
yeah.
Hey, we haven't even talked about the most important thing. Kenner confirmed as canon.
Yeah, I loved that. That and reminded me of stuff. That reminded me of stuff like in Logan when he's like reading the X-Men comics and all that stuff. Like the idea that this thing is real, and even in that world, you know, there's like toys and you know, it's like the opposite. It's like the opposite of real Ghostbusters, where you saw them in the cartoon making the movie, and now it's like the reverse of that. I thought that was super fun. I love that.
Yeah, and listen, again, Ghostbusters fans are vocal, and not everything's for everybody. Yeah. I think Garaka was an awesome villain. Love his backstory. Love the connection to great Nadine. Design. Great design. Love his voice.
Fantastic. Yeah.
But again, first movie, Stay Puft Marshmallow Man and Gozer. Perfection. Second movie. Oh, Vigo. Okay, he was kind of cool. It's just a painting. Oh, the Statue of Liberty. Oh, they're just trying to do Stay Puft again. Third movie. Oh, they brought back Gozer. That's so stupid. You got to do something original. Fourth movie, Garaka. Well, they didn't introduce him early enough. It's like, come on. What do you want
literally
us to do?
Like the they first scene is
in the cold open.
Literally the cold open.
Yeah.
Dude, okay. Jacob's not here to argue with me on this one. I have a nitpick.
Okay.
Okay, go for it.
Cold open. By the way, that actor who goes, "It's freezing." Love that guy.
Oh, dude. He's the best.
He's great.
He made the movie.
The movie's about him.
Yeah. Like, really, at the end of the day.
I think I get why they didn't do it in Afterlife, but the song pumps people up. It pumps me up. I think the song, I bet they tested it with the song, because the way it cuts to black, you could just hear the intro coming in right when the snare drum hits.
Yeah,
Baraka's eyes open. Because to me, going straight to score, For the Ecto chase, I want the song. I
to
like
me,
the song.
That was the one thing that, knowing that they were inspired by real Ghostbusters, when they said that the opening scene was going to be the chase with the sewer dragon, in my head I was just like, oh, this is going to be just like the opening of the Boogeyman episode. We're going to open on New York City mid chase. And the theme song is going to kick in and it's going to feel amazing. So when they didn't do that, that kind of caught me off guard. And not
because I'm wrong.
Actually, I think he's trying to do the Ecto one. Weong,
weong, weong.
Okay, sorry.
That was so awesome. It's like, you know what, Craig? You know what you are? What? Oh, it didn't work. Wait. There it is.
Yeah.
Wrong.
I can't unhear it now. It just sounds like someone going wrong.
Wrong. That's Jacob's hot take, is he doesn't like the Ghostbusters theme song. I love this about him.
This is funny, but I'm glad Jake feels like he can share his truth now, because I know for a long time he was like, well, I don't like it when other people cover the Ghostbusters song. I don't like it when it's then now he's just open about it. He's like, I don't like the song. And that's okay. We still love you.
See, Tony Taylor says, could have had it, the song transitioned to Gary listening into on the stereo. Now,
oh,
that what he
heard
about it? He's like, what?
And they're just
cool.
Like, please turn it off. He's like, are you kidding me?
I play this song every time. Hey, by the way, when he gives Phoebe the big pep talk and she's not there, it's so
funny. That was so good, though. It was simultaneously funny and like heartbreaking, and it was great.
Well, guys, listen, we've covered some ground. We've done some damage tonight. Okay. Not as much damage as we wanted to. Let's before we kill this with fire, literally. By the way, when Trevor goes, "You're doing it." I love that.
Yeah.
That was so good.
That was for me. Okay.
How do you like your babies? Is that how we're ending this?
We didn't really talk about the OG
skin on or skin off, or we do.
But I think like Craig, real quick to point out, you just said we didn't talk about the OGs as much, but like the movie works so well without even talking about them. Not because like let's ignore them, but like even the new stuff and the new storylines and the new everything, like they're so worth talking about and celebrating.
I don't think Ghostbusters Collector liked it, guys.
What?
No?
You know what?
Yo, everyone's big if true. I was not aware until just now.
I don't know. What are you going to do? It's not for everybody.
Yeah.
Okay. So it's for me. Let's talk box office real quick. $45 million last weekend. This is just after Friday this week. So they're estimating it to make around $15 million this weekend, which is a pretty significant drop off. We're not going to sugarcoat. So it's going to be hovering somewhere around $75 million come Monday domestically. International is always slow to roll in. And also, it hasn't opened in like 30 of the markets. So yeah. It's going to be, it's going
be tight,
to be,
but it'll be tight. I think they'll do it.
Well, I think getting to 100 million domestic is really important. It's just like, even in modern, we're not in the times of 2015 and 2016. Like if it makes 100 million domestic, if it makes its budget back domestically, I think there's reason to think that Sony might take a pause. They might take a breath, might take a beat. I hope Jason and Gil get the opportunity to continue the Spangler family story. I think it might be 4 or 5 years. And frankly,
yeah,
I'm fine with that because we need the, I need the ramp. I need five more years of Wyatt Jess content. So
I think it'd be really cool, especially because they talked about it in the press for Afterlife. They've set Winston up for it. And even in the end of Frozen Empire, he says, you know, ghost sightings are on the rise all around the world. Like, to me, this is a perfect time to take, you know, if we get that 4 to 5 year break and tell other Ghostbusters stories and build the world and explore things in smaller ways with smaller budgets, and then come back to New York, having built out the world, and say, but now what about this even bigger threat for the third movie?
Well, we need kids to like Ghostbusters, guys.
That's true. Yeah, yeah.
We need them. And the only kids who like Ghostbusters now are because their parents like it. Like, my brother took my four-year-old nephew, who loved it, was screaming along, laughed at Garaka when he got his hand chopped off. He had a great time. But
yeah,
there's no supporting media to bring kids in.
Yeah.
And I think that is the... If we're just talking franchise expansion over the next decade, I think having... Listen, why is Kung Fu Panda making so much money? Because it's the fourth one in like 8 mm-hmm. years. Kids were introduced to a concept. They liked it. They keep going and seeing it. I think
it's the same with like How to Train Your Dragon, Hotel Transylvania, all that stuff that is just going.
Right. So I think there's huge opportunity.
Kung Fu Panda is also awesome.
Yeah.
I like this from Brandon. You guys are awesome. I haven't seen the movie yet, but as far as I'm concerned, it's a 10 out of 10. There you go.
Yeah, see? That's the spirit.
I like that.
Some people fear it.
Should we do a rapid fire 5-minute
Q&A
and then end this?
Yeah, let's go right. for it.
You guys have been asking questions the whole time. It's been going by fast. So if you have a pressing question, put it in the chat. We'll get to it. We'll rapid fire. Dole, what do you got going on for the rest of this weekend?
Oh, I'm going to sleep. I'm going to have, I think I might order a pizza as well. I'm probably going to watch X-Men 97 for the 15th time. You know, and I think that's might be about it. And then it's just, well, I'll see you Tuesday for Toy Anxiety. And of course, Gotham City Tonight on Wednesday nights, where we're going to be talking more X-Men, probably some of those McFarlane toys, maybe a little bit. Because we do notice we go long when we talk about X-Men.
Absolutely. Hey, by the way, thank you to Hasbro for providing us with these close-up shots here, these HD renders of the new 3 3/4 O-ring style. Hey, G.I. Joe isn't getting O-ring, but Ghostbusters is.
Oh. I like those.
Yeah, they're awesome.
I wish they did some... sad comment music. I do wish they would do just a couple ghosts. Just a couple.
Just a few ghosts. Just a couple.
How long until Ryan starts talking about cancel plasma series because this is the only scale he wants?
Sounds on brand. Give me 3 days, John.
Ghostbusters collector, who would you like to see write and direct the next film? I'm going to go Gil Kenan and Jason Reitman. I'm 2 for 2 with that crew.
It depends. Like,
and they seem to like me.
Absolutely. if it's continuing the Phoebe and Spangler storyline and all that, yes, by all means, it should absolutely be them. But dude, I still get excited about, you know, back after Afterlife, Jason was talking about how he's really excited to expand the world and see some of his favorite directors tackle Ghostbuster stories. And so, you know, I've always thought it would be cool on, for me personally, I know he's got way too much stuff on his plate and original things that are amazing, but I've always thought it'd be cool to see Guillermo del Toro. No, God, no. Del Toro, I'd love to see him do it. I'd love to see what kind of Ghostbusters movie Jordan Peele would make.
Rian Johnson?
I honestly, sure, yeah. Are you kidding me? I'd be down for that.
I'm not kidding you.
Rian
Johnson. Also,
John just DM'd me and said he wanted Bryan Singer to do it.
Phil Lord and Chris Miller.
I want to see them. Oh my gosh, they would be fantastic.
I want to see them do a Ghostbusters.
Greta Gerwig.
Why not? Yeah, that could be fun. I'd be up for that.
Chris Nolan. I'm just naming directors I've heard of.
Ryan's not gonna like Chris Nolan.
Where's that picture of all those directors with Jason Wright when they bought that? Steven Spielberg. Yeah.
That's the short list. Yeah.
Christopher Nolan doing Ghostbusters. It would no longer be called the Ecto One. It would just be called the One.
the Scrambler. Does it come in white?
All right.
Will you Couple be wanting the Ghost Pod, sir?
Ooh. I know what I'm watching tonight. Okay. Mike Davis. just for clarity, John, you did not really DM me that.
I was just having fun with my friends.
Having fun. Trying to have a laugh. All right. Mike Davis, how good did Slimer look on screen? Really good.
He looks so good.
Really great.
Aryan and his whole crew of like, you know, creature creators and all that kind of stuff. Like they, and especially now seeing all the posts that they've made showing all the background stuff and the sculpting and the puppets, and like they do such an incredible job. Like everything looked great.
Hold on. Jacob Walsh says Jordan Peele.
Yeah, 100% agreed. Yeah. Because he's another one who is like, he's got a fantastic comedy background, but he's absolutely shown that he can balance that with horror. And you throw a little action in there and some sci-fi shenanigans, like he could make a fantastic Ghostbusters movie with a completely different perspective and everything else that would still fit into that world. I think it'd be a lot of fun.
You guys are coming up with some fun names in the what was it? Jerry Bruckheimer.
Jerry Bruckheimer.
The Farrelly Brothers. Yeah, you guys are
Wes cool. Anderson.
It might not be as funny, but I think it would be great to see what's his name? Flanagan? Mike Flanagan? Yeah, just have him make the most depressing, heartfelt Ghostbusters thing ever.
I know. All right, guys, we're gonna wrap this up.
That's another good one.
This was a lot of fun tonight. I'm not going to lie. I had a great time. I appreciate my co-hosts. I have not picked up the new Dark Horse comic, Ghostbusters Back in Town. I meant to today, but I didn't. So that's on my radar for this week. And John, where can people find you?
You can find me at John Your K Before, JohnYurCaba, 4 on all the social media stuff. And if you want to take a close look at my work, you should be able to go to my bio in any place, and there's a link to my portfolio website and some other stuff. So you can always, you know, check in and see what I'm cooking up and what kind of stuff I'm into and what I'm doing. So
very cool. Very, very cool. Yes, your Instagram handle is right there on the screen.
It's
your
true.
Screen name. all right, guys. Well, for Ryan Dole and John Yurcaba, appreciate everybody hanging out tonight. Don't forget to subscribe to the channel, subscribe to the podcast, all that stuff. And Abigail, Jacob, and myself will be back next week for more deep dive into Ghostbusters Frozen Empire. And if you haven't seen it, you got to go see it. Oh, wow. Look at that. Oh, and shout out to, you know, all the people who made Ghostbusters a reality again, because
yes,
It's really fun. It's really fun that we get these movies.
Yeah. Like the, as for as stressful as it might be watching box office numbers and all this stuff that we're concerned about, cause we see the bigger picture now as adults and we're concerned about it or whatever. Like every time we get to be excited for a movie or watch a movie or talk with each other about it in the aftermath, like the 4-year-old in me is screaming and like waving his action figures in the air and excited to just like have it, to have Absolutely. It, now, you know?
Yeah. All right, guys.
And thank you, Pete Mosen, for keeping this franchise alive.
Bye. Bye.
Bye, everybody.